Microphone check, 1, 2, 3. Cheddar Cheese in the place to be. Silver Price Report coming at ya, bringing you the daily price of real physical silver. We're getting this one, we're getting to this late. Thought it'd be fitting to do this on the anniversary of the fiat money system. So on Sunday, April 15th, 1971, Nixon took us off the gold standard, put us on a straight paper money fiat standard. And since then, it's been nothing but a party. We're going to talk a little bit about the future of money here in a second. And I'm going to let you know, we're going to put on our tinfoil hats. We're going to go way off into the deep end. But hey, that's what we like to do around here. If it ain't paranoia, it ain't fun. All right. So, I gotta zoom in. All right. This is the average price of physical silver for Friday, August 13th, 2021, priced in US dollars. American Silver Eagle, $32.67. Canadian Maple Leaf, $39.15. Austrian Philharmonic, $27.92. Private Mint, $27.43, with an average price of $29.30. The Premium, $5.73 over spot. So that average up 10 cents between Thursday and Friday. Premium down only about 6 cents. Now, the dollar to silver ratio as of this recording, this is for the 15th, there's $5,966 for every 1 ounce of monetary silver that's out there. I'm no longer calling it investable silver. I think that's misleading because investable silver also includes collectible coins, but that's not what we're into here. We're talking about silver as money or as at least some type of barterable item. So yeah, I'm not gonna call it investment grade or investable silver. I gotta keep in mind this is monetary silver. So something that we've talked about. Oh, actually, let me get into this next picture. All right, so like I said, 50th anniversary of going on a paper money standard, something that we talk about here often is the Great Reset and the push towards digital money. Crypto. You know, Bitcoin, it's on everybody's mind. I mean, pretty much everybody and their mama is buying crypto. You got talks about CBDC, central bank digital currency. We know there's a push for that. These Fed wallets, things called a FedNow account. This is something that we talk about all the time on this show. And if you're new here, I know you've probably heard of it. Because if you're here, then you're probably already into gold and silver, precious metals. You're at least somewhat hip and open to what's going on as far as money. So you should be aware that there is a huge push for digital money. The digital yuan, El Salvador, making Bitcoin legal tender. I saw something about Japan making Bitcoin a legal tender. I think there are some European nations that are moving towards their own digital currency. So digital money from where we're standing right now looks to be the future. So we're going to talk a little bit of how digital money, digital wallet can be rolled out and some of the implications for society. Now, I'm going to let you know, this is straight tinfoil hat stuff. This episode was inspired by an interview with a gentleman named Robert Barnes, who's a lawyer. You can go look up George Gammon's channel and find that that interview is very interesting. I looked into a couple of things that he was saying, freaked me the hell out. So I decided that I would talk about it and bring it to you guys. Now, I'm not saying this is the path that will happen. I am just laying out a possibility of something that can happen. And, you know, I joke around and call this, you know, deep end conspiracy, reptilian lizard people stuff. But seeing as what's going on right now with the vaccine pass and just the lockdowns and everything we've been experiencing since March 2020, you know, a lot of this crazy stuff, this Alex Jones type of stuff that we're seeing, I don't think it's as weird or as far out as what it would have appeared maybe even 5 years ago. So let me talk a little bit about this rollout. So step number one, as we're seeing, is the introduction of a vaccine passport. And this is not just stuff to, you know, go to public school or anything like this. We're seeing in New York, de Blasio mandating that you need to prove that you've been vaccinated in order to get into bars, restaurants. And we'll see how far this can go. We're now starting to see this also in San Francisco. San Francisco tightens COVID vax mandate for customers and workers. San Francisco announced strict restrictions on unvaccinated residents, banning them from many indoor and outdoor gatherings, even if they can prove they tested negative for COVID-19. I was just looking at an article that suggested LA was getting ready to do this. So again, there's some evidence here about these vaccine passport rollouts. So that's the first step in the digital money. And I'm going to connect this idea here a second. You might be like, well, what does the vaccine passport have to do with digital money? Give me a second. So step number two after the rollout of the vaccine passport, and we'll see if this goes nationwide. You know, if there's successful resistance to this vaccine passport stuff, then what I'm talking about is going to be much, much harder to implement. So after the vaccine passport is introduced, you will see the removal of paper vaccine passports. This will be due to counterfeiting, and this will be due to the argument that it's inefficient. And then the vaccine pass will be an app on your phone. Hawaii isn't messing around. Two tourists arrested for forging vaccination cards. In a social media post on Wednesday, Hawaiian Governor David Ige announced that two visitors from the U.S. mainland were arrested by state authorities for allegedly trying to pass off fake proof of vaccination. Police made the arrests following up on a tip from a community member, wrote Ige, who promised that his state's attorney general will investigate and prosecute those who cheat the Safe Travels program, which was established to keep our island safe. So if you remove paper passports and you make it all digital, this problem of counterfeiting, it's no longer a problem. And then also quick tangent here. Man, these people out here snitching. Have they ever heard snitches get stitches? Freaking citizen spies and shit. They're freaking crazy. Mind your own business, you freaking paranoid weirdos. That's all I'm asking. Stay out of my way and stay off my lawn. That's all you got to do. If you feel scared, wear a mask. You know what I mean? Do you get vaccinated, bro? You know, what's the saying? If you scared, go to church. Freaking weirdos. Anyway, so you roll out the vaccine passport. You remove the paper cards on the argument that there's too much forging going on, too much counterfeiting going on. We need it to be safe. We have it right here with your app. You can move your medical records, not just your vaccine status. You can put your medical records on this pass as well. The hospital I go to, my primary care physicians, they have what's called a patient portal, and I can interact with the doctor all through online. So there is a move to push things all online and all digital. And we're going to get to that here in a second. So like I said, step one, vaccine passport. Step two, remove the paper passports. Move it all over to digital. Step three, you have the digital money. You have the digital wallet, the FedNow accounts. You can roll now that out now that you have the infrastructure already in place for the vaccine passport. And then what you can do is you can merge your vaccine passport medical records with your wallet all on to one app. Now, after that happens, you might see... Let me say this. Let me grab my phone. I got my phone right here. So let's say I got my wallet all on here, my vaccine passport. Well, what happens when this runs out of batteries? What happens if I, you know, leave it here at the house when I go somewhere or forget about it? I mean, not only that, this thing is still, I mean, I got a freaking Boost phone. I ain't gonna lie to you. I got minutes. So this thing is still clunky, you know, still awkward to carry. Even if you got a brand new iPhone, it's still got to have it in your pocket, still awkward to carry. So what if we could do something that's much more convenient, some way to carry all that information on a much more convenient manner that's on us all the time? Well, we can do that if we have a quantum tattoo, a biocompatible near-infrared quantum dot delivered to the skin by microneedle patches, record vaccination. Essentially, some type of skin microchipping. And we know RFIDs are already out there. There's a company in Wisconsin that was offering to chip their employees a few years ago with all of their information on there. There's a go look up Wisconsin RFIDs. You'll find a news report on it. Matter of fact, I sampled... you know what? Let's pull it up. Let's go off on a tangent here. I'm going to show you just because you guys think I'm freaking tripping. Let me pull this up for you a second to show you this is already a trend out here. Go to my YouTube studio. I've sampled this news report for a beat tape that I did a few years ago called Electric Gremlin 3. I got Electric Gremlin 4 in the works. Be coming out sometime this year. But here's the sample.
Rice-sized microchip into a willing employee.
Let me start that again.
By injecting a rice-sized microchip into a willing employee's hand, all kinds of data can be programmed into them, from driver's licenses and medical ID cards to logging onto computers.
There you go. I sampled the news report for that beat. Again, you can go look it up. Wisconsin tech company RFID. So anyway, back to these quantum tattoos. So you can remove the phone, get everybody to take this freaking quantum tattoo microchip crap where all of their information is available on that tattoo. Here's from the abstract. Accurate medical record keeping is a major challenge in many low resource settings where well-maintained centralized databases do not exist, contributing to 1.5 million vaccine preventable deaths annually. Here we present an approach to encode medical history on a patient using the spatial distribution of biocompatible near-infrared dots in the dermis. And these infrared quantum dots, there's also, there's another scientific article, I think it's at the NIH.gov. You can look up quantum dots. Basically, from my basic understanding, it's these, I guess you call them proteins that would attach themselves to the virus. Then you use an infrared light on your arm to see if you actually have the virus or not. But let me scroll down a little bit. Paper vaccination cards or certificates are the most widely used records in the developing world, but are subject to error and possessed by only 60% of all households in low and middle income countries. Without accurate vaccination records, healthcare professionals lack the data needed to make informed decisions about administering vaccines, often relying on parental recall. So, okay, my bad, I just wanted to read ahead a little bit. So look, that also plays to what I was talking about. You know, you introduce the Vax Pass, remove the paper proof, introduce the digital wallet, merge the Vax Pass in your wallet, get your tattoo with your freaking barcode tattoo you can scan with all your information on it. But we're not done there, because once that happens, well, why can't all that be linked up to all your smart devices, which is called the Internet of Things? Smart cars, smart houses, smart lamps, Alexa. I've seen smart vacuum cleaners. What is, and then there's something we've talked about. What is the Internet of Things? The interconnection via the Internet of Computing devices embedded in everyday objects, enabling them to send and receive data. Oh yeah, baby, we're going full tempo. I told you, we're going crazy on this one. But we ain't done, because what good is the data without data processing? What would be next after you have all this data and collected? Well, you feed it into an artificial intelligence that would be used to predict and to modify your behavior. This is the World Economic Forum here. This is their section on artificial intelligence. Now, I was going to try to bring up, they have a notorious article called 2030, I'll Own Nothing, Have No Privacy, and Be Happy. Now, I tried to pull that article up, but guess what? Because of the backlash, the World Economic Forum deleted it and banished it from the freaking internet. So you'll just have to take my word for it that it exists. Actually, no, you don't. Let me bring it up here. Right here. Oh, this is the girl's name that wrote it. She's a Danish MP, Ida Auken. Let's go through this rabbit hole here. A brief second. Here, I'm gonna show you this. Oh, you can see, yeah, you can see on my computer, I've already looked this stuff up. I was doing my research and putting this together right before I started this. Okay, so here it is. From the World Economic Forum, let me click this article. They scrubbed it. Can't find it anymore. So now when I try to talk about it, what do I sound like? A freaking crazy conspiracy theorist nut job. This is why I started screenshotting everything. Because I recognize that, they will alter and change information to suit their agenda as well. It's another danger with having everything digital. But anyway, so you take all this information from your smart house, your smart car, your health records, your wallet, all on your freaking barcode, sent to the AI. AI will process all that data and be used to, again, predict and modify your behavior. Here's another article. Where is it at? Okay. Economist Last Economics, The Future of Economics in an AI-Biased World. And what this article briefly talks about is the use of AI in deciding policy. And it's not all like glowing. I just read it because you see it published a little bit ago. I just read it right before putting together this video. It's not all glowing. It does talk about certain problems with AI. But the fact of the matter remains. Look at this. Fancy a career change? AI could help you decide your next move. Well, the AI can only help you decide your next move if it knows something about you. So once again, it's we can see that this is a trend pushed by this organization, which is essentially a lobby for the wealthiest people in the world to bring you under digital control. And what would this mean if, let's say this crazy crap that I'm talking, let's say it happens. What does that mean? Well, that means we've engineered a god. You have an omnipotent, omnipresent intelligence, which is judging your every move. And that's especially true if you incorporate all of this stuff with a Chinese social credit score. It'll punish you for when you do wrong. This eye of Sauron, this consciousness which exists out in the digital cloud that hovers over you will be watching you in weighing your soul on the scales of good and evil. That's exactly how gods are depicted in mythology and in the Abrahamic religions. And that looks like what the trend is going on. Science is the new religion. PhDs are the priesthood. Now I want to end this crazy rant with a metaphor. I'm going to turn this beat off here so we can actually hear the volume. This is a clip from the movie Venom. Now, Venom is my favorite comic book movie right next to Blade. The villain in this movie is named Drake. He's like a biotech individual. Now, Drake is short for dragon, and it's also short for draconian. I'm not going to get too deep into the metaphors here. I really want to do a separate video where I talk about these metaphors in this in this film, but essentially he's an antichrist. You know, he professes to want to save the world, but he saves the world out of contempt for human beings. There's a scene in this movie where he claims that human beings have design flaws. And so the reason he's an antichrist is because the let's call it the archetype. The archetype of Jesus is an individual that saves the world out of love. Now, Drake, the dragon, he sacrifices other people in order to save the world, and he does it out of contempt. Now, if we compare this to the archetype of Jesus, Jesus sacrifices himself out of love in order to save the world. Now, I'm not trying to push anything onto you guys or preach at you in any type of way. I have my own beliefs. I'm sure you have your beliefs. All I'm doing is just using a story and a metaphor to explain the world how I see it. In this clip, I think, even outside of all this crazy, you know, conspiracy stuff I was just talking, I think this clip accurately portrays the status of science today as a religion. And especially with all the stuff going on with the disease, which is floating around here with the lockdowns and all of this stuff, and what these physicians and these doctors and these PhDs are doing to people and what they're saying and how they're acting. I think this scene accurately reflects the culture worldwide and what science has become. It's not science, it's scientism. It's a worship of PhDs. It's a worship of the scientific method as the only inquiry into human knowledge. And with that being said, let's play this thing. Let's blow this up.
Establishing subject baseline. All vital signs are normal.
Put me through.
There's no need to be frightened, Isaac.
There's no need. Isaac.
You know that's a biblical name?
Yes, sir.
God said to Abraham, give me your son, show me you are willing to sacrifice the one thing
most precious to you, and Abraham was willing. You know what's always impressed me about that story?
It isn't Abraham's sacrifice, it's Isaac's. I don't know what kind of God would ask that of someone, but it doesn't change anything for me.
Isaac is still the hero of this story. But look around you. Look at the world.
What do you see? War, poverty, a planet on the brink of collapse. I would argue that God has abandoned us.
He didn't keep his end of the bargain, Isaac, so now it's down to you and me to put this right.
And this time, Isaac, we can.
We will.
This time, I will not abandon us.
Open it.
Thank you. Bring in the next volunteer.
And that's it for today. Hopefully you found this helpful. Hopefully you can incorporate this into your analysis. Until Tuesday morning with Monday's price. Peace out.